Welcome to just one of SkillCap's famous class guides that are the most valuable resource available that actually help you improve in Arena. This is just one of many videos that are a part of a comprehensive course for how to play Fire Mage like a pro. We spent hundreds of hours developing these courses with players that have spent thousands of hours perfecting their craft. This allows you to learn all the secrets and strategies of the world's best in just a matter of minutes. For everything you need to go from feeling hopeless in PvP to being the teammate everyone wants and actually start climbing, be sure to check out SkillCapped after this if you're serious about improving. Hey everyone, what's up and welcome to step 2 of our Fire Mage course. Step 2 is all about the good stuff, damage. We're going to be taking a look at how to deal the most optimal sustain damage, how you execute your burst, and even providing you with small tricks on how you can min-max your damage beyond that, before covering the age-old question, how do you deal damage while you're being trained? So, without any further delay, let's jump straight into it. First of all, let's discuss damage, which is one of, if not the most important factors in Arena. You could be the best WoW player in existence and counter every single move your opponent makes, be amazing defensively, or even create the perfect 3v1 setups every single time. But let's face it, all of that is useless if you're not just doing damage and killing your opponents. Now, damage can be separated into two parts. You've got your consistent damage on one side and your burst damage on the other. In this section, we're going to be covering your standard consistent damage, what you should be doing damage-wise when you're not bursting. This is a strange section for Fire Mages as your damage outside of burst isn't really all that impactful or important. Your sustained damage is more about preparing for your burst windows. And the biggest contributing factor here is pyrokinesis. Even with a few nerfs, this ability, as you can see, reduces the cooldown of your combustion every time you fireball. This is the main source of your consistent damage, fireball. You also can't neglect just how much fireball really does, making sure to utilize Tinder and Firestarter in conjunction with Flame Cannon in matchups like Caster Mirrors, for instance, can get you some surprisingly good sustained damage going on. To bolster this, you can look to never keep Fire Blast at 3 stacks and use them after a fireball crit to get some added damage from a Hot Streak Pyro Blast. Although you also want to make sure that you've got 3 stacks of Fire Blast ready for your burst window, so if that's coming up, then consider holding onto them. But while on paper, the sustained damage rotation is as easy as pressing Fireball and weaving in Fire Blasts on crits to get Hot Streaks for Pyro Blasts, the point remains that focusing on your sustained damage just isn't something that you can get away with or should even think about in most matchups and compositions as a Fire Mage. Your sustained damage should always take more of a backseat to things like surviving, kiting, securing CC, preparing for your next burst window, or even peeling. But we'll go through all of that later in the video. Alright, so now with consistent damage out of the way, let's get to the important stuff. Burst damage. Fire Mages are known for one thing in particular, and that is their burst. No other caster comes remotely close to the amount of burst they're capable of, easily being able to solo any target 100-0 in the blink of an eye without even casting a single spell. So, how do you do it? Well, your burst simply consists of pretty much all of your instant damage abilities. So, Fire Blast, Pyro Blast with Hot Streak, Meteor, Phoenix Flames, coupled, of course, with Combustion. All we're doing here is breaking down the standard burst rotation, but later in the video, we'll discuss how to min-max this and give you ways to make this burst even more potent. Alright. So first of all, you're going to want to drop Meteor on top of your target, ideally having the target stunned prior by your teammate. After that, you're going to want to pop Combustion. Why you combust after Meteor is that you have a few seconds before it hits. This way you'll get all the spells to hit at relatively the same time for that huge burst of damage. Then you'll want to instantly Fire Blast into Fire Blast, which will in turn give you a Hot Streak. Then, of course, you use your Hot Streak proc on a Pyro Blast. This will in turn give you another Heating Up proc, to which you'll follow up with another Fire Blast to give you your second Pyro. And then you'll use Phoenix Flames if you're not at risk of breaking CC to give you yet another Pyro, rotating Fire Blasts back in as they come off CD. Remember, when executing your burst window, both Combustion and Fire Blast are off the global, so the brunt of your damage is all done in 2 global cooldowns, both of which being your Pyro Blasts, excluding the Phoenix Flames later into the rotation. That's what makes your burst so explosive and so hard to deal with. But we can't have Combustion for every single burst window, at least not now anyway, after the nerfs to Pyrokinesis, So how do you burst outside of combust? So unlike with your combust rotation, first off, you're going to want to pull a heating up proc. What I mean by this is either using Fire Blast a few seconds prior to your burst window, or even utilizing Tinder and Firestarter to make sure that you get one. Afterwards, you're going to then want to cast a Rune of Power. Now, this step can obviously be skipped in some scenarios. It's not always the case that you can do this, but if you can, it's for sure worth it. Then you'll want to do the same as before, drop your meteor, followed up by a Fire Blast, which because of your initial heating up proc, it'll grant you a Pyroblast. Then of course, spend your hot streak on that Pyroblast. Now, depending on if this crits, you can then Fire Blast into another Pyro or Fire Blast twice if it doesn't to get another Pyro. Then, same as before, throw out Phoenix Flames and Fire Blasts as you get them. But as mentioned, stay tuned for how to min-max the burst rotation later in the guide. Alright, now with a good understanding on the basics behind sustained damage and how you should execute your burst, let's now go over something that you'll encounter in every single arena game and that can greatly swing the momentum of any game, the opener. Before the game starts, the first thing that we're going to of course want to do is buff AI, that's a given. Then with anywhere between 25 to 10 seconds left before the arena starts, you're going to want to buff your Blazing Barrier. Because of our recommended legendary Triune Ward, this is going to get all three of your barriers up and the cooldown reset for the second the gates open. The result of this will be at least a 30 second duration on three barriers while also having the cooldown ready if anything does end up going sour in the opener. After that, your goal is to get in invisibility. Now, this lasts 20 seconds and takes 3 seconds to activate, so it is sometimes worth hanging back if your enemies are rushing toward you. There is also a mind game to this if you're facing enemy mages. The goal is to always try and get the later invisibility if possible. So, with a clean invis, you have 20 seconds to work with. From here, it's hard to say exactly what you should do, as what you're expected to do in openers is very much on a comp by comp basis. What we do recommend watching some of our matchup guides to see what's expected from you depending on which comp you're facing or playing. But in general, it can be divided into three categories or a mixture of all three. The first of which is going for CC. So this could be casting a sheep on a DPS before then pushing in for a DB Ring of Frost onto a healer, or depending on positioning a DB Breath into Polymorph or Ring of Frost on the healer alone. Alternatively, even just simply a polymorph on the healer out of your invis, but bear in mind the higher rating that you get, teams will be able to easily anticipate this and prevent your opener. And again, you could just open with damage, or even better, combine a polymorph out of invis, followed by then committing to your burst rotation. So for example, if you're playing rogue mage, your rogue might sap the healer. You polymorph the off target while you then stun and lock down the kill target and proceed to do a burst rotation in a 3v1 scenario. And then there are comps where openers are not even all that important. Take Elemental Fire Mage for instance. It's sometimes worth it to chill, sit back, and let your Ellie get ready for your setup. Also, in some cases, if you're facing something like Rogue Mage Mirrors or even Cleaves running straight at your healer, simply just sitting in invis and waiting to double DB can be a great way to prevent a lot of opening pressure. Anyway, moving on, one of the hardest things for any less experienced player, or even veterans for that matter, is to be able to handle being trained. The constant threat of two melee on you or casters spiking your health with every ability can make everything seem so much harder, and you may find yourself shutting down and ending up doing no damage, no CC, and end up purely focusing on surviving. Well, this is a concept that we're going to be exploring and helping you deal with throughout this course. First of which though is taking a look at how you deal damage while being trained. Then later we're going to look at how you survive and how you can still contribute to your team's kill attempts all while being trained. To start, Fire Mage is very lucky and subsequently very strong because a lot of their damage, as we know, is instant cast. This makes it incredibly easy to always be able to get your damage out, even if someone is smashing your face in, as not a single ability requires any cast time. What you don't want to be doing though, and a mistake some lesser experienced mages make, is focusing too much on dealing consistent damage. This is something that we touched on in the consistent damage portion of this guide. When you're being trained, it should always heavily take a backseat. I'm not saying that you shouldn't do any at all, but what you should be doing is making sure you prioritize surviving, CCing, and bursting over that consistent pressure. So instead of standing still, pressing fireball with two melees trucking you, you can look to build distance before trying to get some fireballs out to reduce your combustion CD or get some consistent pressure building. A great tool for doing this, as well as allowing you to get your combust back faster, is the combination of Firestarter and Tinder, meaning every 8 seconds, you can cast a fireball with 50% faster cast speed, as well as it dealing more damage, and if used on a target above 90%, will give a guaranteed critical strike. Leaving this in combined with a Fire Blast into a Pyroblast can allow you to get some decent damage out even while being trained, even if it is your lowest priority. But the key takeaway here is that while being trained, it's only the burst aspect of your damage which is going to be important, and that's all instant cast. Moving on, no matter how much you practice your burst rotation, it's always the case that you'll see some clip, watch a stream, or even face somebody playing the same class as you that seems to always deal more damage, or in the case of Fire Mage, more burst. Well, in most cases, this is down to the fact that they probably know some small tips or tricks that you might not. In this case though, you're in luck, as our mage consultant Mauro spilled the beans and shared with us how he min-maxes his damage. The first of which is the importance of the Infernal Cascade Conduit. This is why Fire's Burst is so potent, and the main reason that you're always wanting to Fire Blast twice before the impact of your Meteor. Flame Cannon, if you're playing it, is an integral part of making sure your burst does the maximum amount of damage. Having 5 stacks of it just before you unload your burst increases your damage by 15%. Remember, this lasts 5 seconds after you move as well, more than enough time to unload all your damage. Beyond that, as we know, combustion is the key to unlocking your full burst potential. Well, there are a few rules you can abide by to maximize it. First of all, and something that you can do with ease, is to make sure that you always have 3 charges of Fire Blast ready to go, not only for your Infernal Cascade buff, but also for the hot streaks. Then we've got Meteor placement. Meteor, if you didn't know, shares damage between all targets hit. This means that your goal should be to always only hit one target. You can do this more easily by doing what's called edging your meteor, simply placing the reticle in a way where only the edge hits that one player. With combustion being as scary as it is, it means enemies are very vigilant and on the lookout for it. The way to play around this, and something you should naturally always be doing, is to make your combustion setups as clean as possible. So aiming to secure that 3v1 scenario as frequently as you can, or at least having CC on the enemy healer if you're not focusing him. Another big difference maker for combustion damage is to always make sure that you have Arcane Intellect up prior. Most compositions have a purge available to them, so you'll often find that your AI is being removed throughout the game. This adds a 5% increase to your overall intellect, and with Int being your best stat, the damage this provides should never be overlooked. Always make sure that you rebuff this before attempting to deal any damage. If this is something that you struggle with, we recommend just downloading a weak aura to remind you when you're missing it. Next up, most players are aware that if you see a meteor, it's more often than not going to mean combustion if the mage has it ready. This can actually be used to your advantage, doing what's known as a quick combustion burst. Say for instance, you've counterspelled an enemy and they're unable to use their defensives, or they've dropped a tad low. You can surprise enemies by instantly starting your burst rotation without the meteor. So just unloading double Fire Blast Pyroblast, or even a Tinder Fireball into Combustion Fire Blast Pyroblast. Thanks to the lack of global cooldown on Fire Blast, this can allow you to do upwards of 20k damage in the span of a GCD. Finally, the last thing I want to touch on, which is again important to min-maxing your damage, is going to be the Night Fae Covenant ability Shifting Power. While this may at face value seem like something that you can use around the back of a pillar to get your combust back, which honestly for the most part it is, the damage that this ability provides shouldn't be underestimated either, both from the Shifting Power itself and the ability to gain back Fire Blast charges. So after you've unloaded your burst, you can then extend the window that you're doing damage in by quickly getting your Fire Blast charges back for that extra bit of damage. Alright, last up, to wrap the damage portion of this course up, we're going to be taking a look at some of the Fire Mage interactions with other classes. First up, Sky Fury Totem and Power Infusion are 2 buffs, which aid greatly in improving your burst damage, and should always be used for yourself instead of for your partners. Remind your priests to always PI you during your combust, and the same with shamans. Having Sky Fury for your combustion is a flat out 20% damage increase, and should always be used solely for that reason. Having these extra modifiers during your burst window and at the correct time are how top players make their kill setups pack that extra punch. Next up, the bane of a Fire Mage's existence is the Hunter ability Roar of Sacrifice. This ability, provided by the Hunter's pet, makes the target completely immune to critical strikes, which makes your combustion basically worthless. As a result, whenever facing a Hunter, you're going to have to play around this, either by hoping the Hunter wastes it, which is unlikely, or by CCing the pet. DB, Ring of Frost, Polymorph are all great tools to keep the pet from being able to Roar of Sacrifice your kill target. So, always bear in mind and consider how you're going to play around it before wasting your combust. And the final interaction is with other mages and Kleptomania. This is something every mage versus mage battle ends with, each mage trying to prevent the other's combust by instantly using Spellsteal combined with Kleptomania to remove it. While a bit of a mind game for the most part, you should always treat the mage like I just explained with the Hunter pet. Things like locking him on Arcane before combusting, making sure to have him stunned, polyed, DB'd, or any CC which will prevent him from spell stealing, or like mentioned earlier, go for the instant surprise combust. And the same rule applies to when he combusts as well. You should always be ready to Klepto and then cancel to prevent him from stealing it back. And if the mage doesn't have Klepto ready, you should always look to hold on to their combustion instead. A cool mind game here is to wait for the enemy mage to combust, spell steal his, and don't cancel it. He will steal it back, and you can then have a free combustion for yourself. Alright everyone, that's going to conclude part 2 of our Fire Mage course. And be sure to check out part 3 of this course, where we go over setups and winning games, including a look at how you should use your CC, as well as perfect your setups. But, as always, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.